Nice to have you here, Doris.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be here.
Doris, you were on television at Channel 7 back in the probably the early 60s. These have been a lot of years ago, and you haven't thought a lot about this lately. But it was a very early children's show. But I wanted to kind of know a little more about you. You were a Lutheran minister's wife, but you also, you're instinctively born to be a writer, right?
I know I was born to be a writer and a storyteller. And I was married 56 years to a Lutheran minister.
And his name was?
Reverend Laverne Kampfe.
And would be known in Waverly, among other ways, as the chaplain out at Bartle's home.
Correct. Mm-hmm. And the parish, Zion Lutheran, in Waterloo for many, many years.
Okay.
On the corner of Kimball and Fourth.
And your home is up in beautiful Clayton County and in the town of Monona?
That's where I was born, and I claim it as where I love the country and the hills and the honeysuckles and the wildflowers and the trout streams.
And the beautiful
It
river.
Truly is the beautiful part of the world.
Right. And your husband's work took him, among other places, to Minneapolis?
Yes, I've lived in five different states, mm-hmm. 18 different houses. So sometimes I have felt like a gypsy.
But you came to, and this brings us to the, and then in later years, just to put this in, because I think it's important to understanding how you did what you did, that you were sort of beginning to develop your instincts as a storyteller, and you have since become developed the storytelling art and have practiced that all over Iowa for many years.
That is true. I can't believe how far I've traveled with stories.
Right, telling stories.
I am thrilled to have been able to start out at KWWL.
So let's then, your husband came to, as a matter of fact, I think you said he was the building pastor for Zion Lutheran there.
That's
at Kimball
correct.
And Forest Street.
And it was Hovey Braun's first architectural plan.
Hovey Braun did that.
Yes, a good architect and a good friend.
Oh yes, I know him mm-hmm. very well. Yes, that's really interesting. And you, in your life with your husband, had college experience, and so you said, "I'm going to go to college."
That's true. I married really young, mm-hmm. and I think I was 20. And when I moved to Waterloo, I had this opportunity to go to University of Northern Iowa with a friend. We both read so many books, and she said to me, "Why don't we enroll in college?" Neither one of us were able to go when we were young girls. So we did that, and that was like opening the window of the world to me, because then I became a student of James Hurst. I had four semesters with Jim.
And that would be an inspiration.
Oh, very inspirational. And I was taking creative drama for children with Dr. Williams. And that was, both of these things were exciting to me because so much of my life prior to this had naturally been doing things with my husband mm-hmm. in the church or in the community. So now it was like my window was opening.
And you were taking a writing course at UNI.
Yes, I did.
Mm-hmm. And that was, as we chatted earlier, was kind of the key that opened the door to your television experience, because you didn't think he gave you a fair grade.
It was Dr. Williams, really, who I felt didn't give me a fair
okay.
grade. He was the creative drama for children instructor.
All right.
And I thought I should have been an A student, and I was one. And so out of frustration that I had received a C for the semester, I think sometimes anger motivates certain people, and it did me. And I had two children at home who I thought watched television to excessive amounts, but as long as they kept their grades up, we let them watch all the TV they wanted to watch. But I thought that there could be something more exciting and educational for children. And that's how I happened to make up my mind one day to just drive from West Waterloo downtown and walk in the studio and say, here I am. How would you like a new show, a new kind of program for children? Something that I don't think anybody has anywhere right now, even nationwide. And we're talking about when it was still black and white TV.
Of course. So you go.
It's a long time ago.
You go to the insurance building at the East 4th and Franklin in Waterloo, mm-hmm. and you walk in the door, and you are ushered into the office of a dear friend of mine and colleague, a Southern gentleman by the name of James Bradley.
Yes.
That must have been a bit.
A bit what?
Overwhelming.
Overwhelming. No, I didn't feel overwhelmed. I remember feeling more.
He was sort of an overpowering personality in some ways in his general.
I found him really quite interesting.
Yes, indeed. He was a very interesting mm-hmm. man.
And he did say he had just arrived on the scene, and what did I have in mind?
Mm-hmm. And this would. The time frame, as near as we can place it in, with your recollection and what I know about the the development of staff at Channel 7, would probably put it in the early 60s. So black and white television. Jim Bradley is the vice president of programming and really the television station manager for Robert Buckmaster, who was the CEO. So you sit down in Bradley's office, and what do you pitch to him?
I hadn't really thought about it the way people should.
But look, if I could, forgive me, but you just think that television programs that are available for children are bad.
Oh, I thought they were awful. And that even goes back to when we lived in Minneapolis, prior to moving to Waterloo, and my children were both born, well, one was born in Minneapolis, and she was 5 years old when we moved to Waterloo. And basically, now they were like junior high age. And I thought, they watch so much junk. And I thought, there is nothing for children where they learn about other cultures. Remember, we're talking about way before Sesame Street, and way, way before anybody thought about some of these things. But I really seriously had thought about the fact that there wasn't anything about learning about people that live somewhere else or in another culture. And I love everything connected with nature. And I, at that time, there was nothing that had anything to do with nature on television either. And so I told Jim, I would like to write stories, scripts, my own, that I would pitch about other countries. Like, I'll write a story about China. At that time, nobody in this country could go to China. Mm-hmm. We're talking, you know, again, when once Nixon got there, then people were able to go later in the 70s. But at this time, nobody could go. So one of the stories was Blue Blue Dragonfly Finds His Way Back to China.
Okay.
And I wrote it historically about China because I was I was majoring in Oriental history at the time. And so somebody once said to me a long time ago, there isn't such a thing as just, you know, having something happen. You have to train yourself, get your training of whatever it is, get educated in whatever you want to do, and someday it'll happen. Mm-hmm. And it was, all of a sudden it was happening because it seemed like I was in the right place at the right time.
But you had a very vague idea of what you wanted to do. You knew nothing about television.
I did not know anything about television at the time.
But Jim Bradley said, let's give it a try.
Yes.
And as a matter of fact, your recollection is he was looking for an excuse to get rid of the children's program host.
Yes, that's true. His very words were, I'd like to can
Mike.
Whoever it was, Captain So-and-so. We'll give you his slot.
May have been Captain Jet or something.
I'm not sure. The whole,
in any event, it sounds like Bradley.
Yes, and I thought, I can't believe this is really happening. No, and I had no scripts. written in advance, nothing. It, I just said, I would like to do this, as I mentioned, mm-hmm. and I figured I did have training in other things, but I had no training in television, none whatsoever. And mm-hmm. and when he said to me, you know, you can't ramble, you can't do, one thing you must do, and that's one thing with television you'll learn right away, you have to be exactly at the very time.
You have to adhere to time.
Yes, and so I started writing my scripts, timing myself with a clock I used to cook in the kitchen. Uh-huh. So I would be exactly, the words would come out exactly at the moment that cameraman told me were going off.
But I have a copy of one of your, several of your scripts here, but you didn't actually, you didn't read the scripts.
Oh no, I spoke orally.
Because you're a storyteller.
Yes. I would not, you know, think of looking at something or reading it.
But you crafted the story ahead of time.
I wrote the story myself.
As a manuscript.
Mm-hmm.
But then you actually delivered it as a storyteller.
Yeah, and it was really very loose and free, because since I just knew that, actually I worked around time. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you know that's one of the most important things working in television, is your time, what you do with that time.
In other words, you were flexible as you, as they started to give you the countdown, you'd mm-hmm. start to wrap up the story. Mm-hmm. And your recollection is this was a 15-minute format.
I think it was. Mm-hmm. It goes so far back. The cameraman was, I can't remember his name right now, but he was a very good cameraman. Mm-hmm. I remember that.
And they did it with probably with one camera then?
Yes.
Okay.
One camera. And I brought children as part of the cast. I skipped the History of Iowa course that I was taking at UNI and asked Dr. Emma Plain if I could do that and still take the test at the end of the semester, and told her I was going to do a TV show. And she said, you may do that. Okay. So actually, I left History of Iowa up at UNI, and I drove home between classes and picked up these children that lived around Ivanhoe Road where I lived. The neighborhood children.
Mention some of the names.
Dr. Bill Dreyer's little boy, Billy. Dr. Wyrock, Robert Wyrock's children, Bobby and John. And I just can't remember all their names.
No, of course.
Probably
not.
Teddy Lederman, because he's now a doctor, I guess, in Waterloo, but then he was just a little boy. He was just a little tiny boy.
Yeah.
And it was neighborhood kids, and the mothers, that we had to have them ready, because I didn't dare not get across those tracks, because
right.
the train cut off Waterloo, you know. And if I didn't get across those railroad tracks from West Waterloo to get to the studio, we'd be late. So there was no time for the usual.
So you had, what, basically the number of kids you could get in your car?
I think I had five.
Were they always the same children?
Yes.
Oh. So they were your...
And lots of other children wanted to do it, and their mothers asked me, couldn't they do it? And I said, well, no, I'm just going to work. I knew these children, and I knew how they would be on the set.
Uh-huh.
And they were like a model cast.
Well, tell me what kind of, how did you, you talked to the children.
Yeah, it was like we were having a story time.
Okay.
In a home library.
Okay.
With lots of bookcases, shelves behind me, and
shelf back mm-hmm. set background,
mm-hmm.
And the camera then just followed the children reacted to
yes
okay.
And I think if I recall too, they could sometimes they asked questions
yeah.
and we you know they interact
they
interacted
interact with
mm-hmm.
you. Okay. And you also brought in some props then that would be relevant to the...
Oh, yes, you know, I really was the writer and the performer, but suddenly I thought I was a marketing person because I had this brilliant idea, which I thought was quite brilliant, that if we were doing, like, I did one story about birds, so I said, let's go to Foster's or Platt's or somewhere and let's get some birdhouses. So we would like promote different places. Whatever the stories were about, we'd get some promotion items in that would, you know, connect with the stories.
Okay.
Which was, I think, a novel idea to get advertising easy and fast.
See if you could boost the commercial content.
Yeah. Which I don't know why I got into that, but that's how, you know, a person's mind works sometimes.
Well, let me take you back. Now, in my hand, I have a script that is under Doris Kampfe's name, and the title is Capital Capers, and the first line is Splash, splash, squiggles, squish, squash. So that has a very strong connection to your to where you came from, which is up in Clayton County.
Yes, that was my first story. And I wrote it because I love Iowa and I love the river. And I went on this paddle wheel boat as a child called the Capitol. So I thought, why don't I structure a story about animals? And again, the animals were animals of people I knew in Waterloo. Uh-huh. Like my neighbor had a doxy dog called Duchess. Another one had Rusty, the Cocker Spaniel. And so people that were my friends who had these animals, I made them the characters in that story. And my own daughter had the turtle, which ended up dying and dried up in the container one day, and she said it didn't have a bad death because it didn't suffer, it just dried up. So I put a turtle as the main character in there as one of them. He was the pilot of the boat.
Oh, I see.
I don't remember what I called him. He had a darling name now. Mm. Torkelson, Captain Torkelson, that was it, Turtle Torkelson. And then I had a parakeet because my daughter had a pet parakeet from George and George's. And so we had Georgie on board with his mother and eating, you know, hearts, bird seed and whatever. And so actually, I had that story in my mind only because of my love of the river and of Northeast Iowa. Okay. And where the boats came. As a child, it was so wonderful. And so I had all these animals experiencing what I experienced.
And you told it in terms that young children would identify with as these animal characters then.
Mm-hmm.
But I have in my hand here again is a very sort of a scrap of paper which kind of represents what you would work from rather than this typewritten script, which was the story structure.
A long time ago, a friend said to me, as a writer, whenever you get an idea, no matter where you are, write. Hmm. Write it down. And so I have all this assortment of pieces of napkins, some restaurants, and theater programs. And I don't know what that piece of paper was. But after Jim said, yes, I could be on KWWL, I was so excited. And I thought, I don't even have one script. What am I going to do? And whatever that day was, wherever that piece of paper was, that's where I roughly wrote what I did.
How the dragonfly found his way back to China.
Yep, that was a great story, and I changed that later, years later, after I moved to Chicago, to Know Who You Are. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that little piece of paper is what I began working from. Mm-hmm. So I don't think that you have to write out a whole, like I did professionally on that other page. You know, camera does this, you know, enter so-and-so. This worked beautifully.
It worked because it was, people were inventing television at that time.
Yes.
And Jim was willing to give you some leeway in doing
When I think of the gamble he took, mm-hmm. I could have come on and been boring. But instead we had floods of letters from people all over Iowa.
I was going to ask you about that. You had
and
good reactions.
Yes, and I especially enjoyed letters from people who were shut in, uh-huh. elderly people. And I'm elderly now, but then I was young. And I can remember thinking, though, how wonderful that this really old lady in this town is saying, oh, the story about the Purple Martins reminded me of her Purple Martins, you know, or the story about a black-eyed Susan sleeps in school reminds me of our trip to Mexico. Or my flowers that are black-eyed Susans. That's the kind of stuff that happened.
Mm-hmm.
So that was very exciting.
Mm-hmm. And the neighborhood kids were stuck right with you during the time you did the show?
They were really wonderful. They sure were.
Of course, I imagine they got a lot of attention from their friends about
doing
Channel 7.
Other mothers were begging me to put their children on. Really, I just, you know, knew I had to have it close by me. I couldn't drive very far to pick them up, and I just, well, it worked out very well. I only remember once somebody on the camera crew or working there dropped something behind the backdrop, mm-hmm. and it was a very loud noise, and that was when I first learned to improvise. So then I started, you know, I had to improvise. Well, that was certainly whatever, you know.
So you put that into the story.
I did. Yeah. I added it to the story.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was whatever this experience was. It was a rich experience in your life. It was relatively short-lived because
very short.
Your family moved on to Chicago.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. And you left Channel 7 behind. And as we construct this, your show, as a matter of fact, we know this because we talked about the fact that Channel 7 was, while you were still there, considering doing bringing the romper room format into the afternoon.
Yes, Jim had told me that he would like to have me audition for a news show they were going to bring in that was nationwide called Romper Room.
Mm-hmm. It was a syndicated show
yes.
that was formatted with
uh-huh.
the local
So voice. I was just prior to Romper Room.
Mm-hmm.
And I did audition for that and knew immediately it wasn't for me because I did not like anything that was so organized by somebody else, where I had to say every word exactly as it was mailed to me or given to me. After the freedom
mm-hmm.
of what I had been doing was so beautiful,
yeah.
and the opportunity to do that, it was just so wonderful. And actually, as I'm talking about this, Grant, I'm thinking maybe that's what even led me to become what I've become.
Uh-huh.
Because in my storytelling with the Iowa Arts Council, and Very Special Arts Iowa, I have still this creative freedom. I still am totally able to choose what I wish to tell and how I would like to tell it. And I think that's probably how this opportunity got me started. Oh, I know it is.
Yeah, it was this little scrap of television history in which you certainly cut some new ground for creating something that would be educational and appropriate for children.
Yes, definitely. Definitely educational, but highly entertaining, and that's still how I work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's still how I function and what I do.
Well, you have some, when you moved to Chicago, you obviously didn't lose your artistic instincts, and you did some writing there and had some contact with some fairly well-known television vehicles, including Days of Our Lives, did you say?
I ended up being a ghostwriter for As the World Turns.
As the World Turns. Tell us about how that happened.
I had a lawyer friend in Palatine, Illinois, who said, I think you'd like to meet Warren Swanson, who's a criminal lawyer in Chicago. He writes for As the World Turns.
Mm.
He knew the woman who started that soap opera. And so every Wednesday I'd get on the train, travel for 40 minutes, and go into Chicago and give him scripts. So I did that for a while. And I also was doing live shows. I was put in contact via our Lutheran church there, really,
mm-hmm.
with a young man who was on drugs and wanting to drop out of the university in his final semester. And his parents asked my husband if I would do something with him to keep him out of the scene and still in college. And he became my musician. And he wrote songs and played a guitar and no amplification. It would belong to his grandfather. And we traveled around Chicago. We went to the classiest country clubs and the high crime areas of Chicago and did stories and songs. And mostly we were in black neighborhoods, and so I wrote the scripts and then stories based on my, again, personal experiences here in Waterloo in the 60s teaching Head Start.
Well, that's another, so you were, it's like, you were, you know, a Head Start teacher.
Yeah, I was doing a lot. A lot of different things, but all fun things.
But again, your art as you have developed it was really the prototype for that, was the way you did that television show, which was as a storyteller. You just sat down with the kids.
Yeah. And, yes.
And you formalized that then into a presentation with this young man in Chicago.
Exactly.
And then you came back to Iowa. When you came back to Iowa, it was to Waverly, is that right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And that's when you got involved with the Iowa Arts Council.
I didn't know anybody in Waverly. We came there for my husband's work. Mm-hmm. And I had nothing to do. And I'd been away now, 16 years from Waterloo. Mm-hmm. And so many of my friends in Waterloo, too, had moved away. And I didn't have anything to do. And I thought, I need to be doing something. And, you know, it's like my friend Sam Dunaff once said, we artists are always creating. We don't even care if we get paid. Most of us don't even earn big money. Well, he did. He wrote for, worked with Bob Hope and Lucille Ball. But he said to me, whether we get any money or we don't get any money, we have to do what artistic thing is that we do. And I applied then to the Iowa Arts Council as a storyteller and was accepted. And that began 21 years ago. And then 10 years ago, I applied to the Very Special Arts Iowa.
And that's the handicap.
Yes, and where children who have special needs are mainstreamed in the public schools. Mm-hmm. So that took me all over the state of Iowa. Again, doing stories very much like I did at KWWL. Totally, almost improvising. I mean, having an idea of what I was going to do and writing it, but always oral telling and it involving the children in the stories. Sometimes I take costume props with me, which are a lot of fun for them. Mm-hmm. And I tell stories even yet today, basically that people don't know. If I don't write them, I choose ones too that I think they don't know, and that's contrary to what most storytellers do. Because most storytellers take other people's stories, and when they appear with children, they tell a tale already well known. And I like to go in, just like I did at KWWL, and do something nobody has ever heard. And they have so much fun. And then I tell them, I'm not the only storyteller. Everyone here is a storyteller. Mm-hmm. I want you to go home and tell a story to somebody. You can tell one I told you, and don't even have to tell it like I told it. Just tell what you remember, because everyone has stories in their hearts. Mm-hmm. And so I always emphasize that, because I figure that, you know, if the children know and the people know, even the teachers sometimes don't know how to do stories. And if they know there isn't a how to do, maybe, just do it.
Just tell it.
Just tell it. Mm-hmm. You know, and if it's something that's precious to you, somebody else is going to find it precious to them. And it's true. I have a lot of training and background, and in literature, like with James Hurst, mm-hmm. and like with Dr. Williams, but or even my own family. We lived in a little tiny town in northeast Iowa, and
Monona,
and I think our family read every book in that library. I mean, we grew up with the books. And everybody says to me, oh, do you get a book and tell a story out of a book? You know, it's funny, I really usually don't, because people have so many good stories they tell me that are their personal stories, mm-hmm. and I just retell them. It's more like I'm on the folk art roster too in Iowa, because I am what's considered a folk artist. we tell the stories of the people. Mm-hmm. And that's mostly, you know, what we did on our front porch when we were little kids and listened to our parents and grandparents. Yeah. How about that?
Right.
There is one thing I'd like to talk about yet.
Yeah. Well, just tell me, and then before we restart.
Yeah. I never believed I'd ever get on boats, paddle wheel boats.
Okay.
I just thought of that now, the connection. See, I'm a storyteller for the Delta Steamboat Line.
Oh, really?
Oh. So I've since 1990 or 95, for a long time, I go on board the paddle wheels.
You do?
And I do river stories for them. Oh. I just thought that would connect and tie in with the capital.
We'll do that. I'll reintroduce then, and we'll connect this up. You going? Okay, we had replace a battery here, and we're just going to conclude the interview shortly. But as Jesse's been getting a fresh battery, Doris, I've been talking about. We were talking about the fact that stories are really the glue of human experience, and you tell the kinder that are much more intimate and personal than what we get on television, which has kind of become the storyteller for Americans now. But you happen to think of a connection here, your childhood connection to the Capitol, the riverboat.
Yes.
And the fact that you've seen a lot of that river from the riverboats that ply that stream today.
I never ever believed I'd ever be on television like I was in the 60s. Yeah. And I never believed I could write that many scripts. And I eventually, after I moved back to Waverly, Iowa, and I was telling you I didn't know what to do with myself, mm-hmm. I called New Orleans, the Delta Steamboat Line. I'd always wanted to go on the paddlewheel boat. They had the Mississippi Queen and mm-hmm. the Delta Queen. Mm-hmm. And so I called there and I asked for the program director, pretty much like I went into KWWL. Like somebody said, how do you get these things? I said, you've got to have a lot of guts, mm-hmm. a lot of guts, mm-hmm. a lot of faith in yourself that you can do it. And I think more than that, a love mm-hmm. of people. Mm-hmm. And I said, I called New Orleans and I couldn't believe it. They called me back right away with a contract to go on board from St. Louis to St. Paul a week. And from that day on in 1990, every year I could choose any cruise of theirs, any time of the year, and I immediately chose October, because uh-huh. that would be the most beautiful in the Mississippi. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. And I told stories about people that lived along the river. Then one day they called me and said, would you fly to Pittsburgh? Mm. We want you to get on board. It was the American Queen now, the new one, the big one. Mm. And I would go on that river, the Ohio, the Cumberland, the Tennessee, and end up at Nashville. And I said, would I? My bag's already packed. And they'd fly my husband and me. He could always go, he always said, I took him on so many wonderful trips and events. And so anyway, they would fly both of us to where it would begin. And so I couldn't believe, on the American Queen, this is their biggest boat. Yeah. And it was the inaugural year for that particular paddle wheel. And you know what happened? They had built it. It was the smokestacks, like all the original boats mm-hmm. on the Mississippi. And I'm a night person. I work often at night. People in my neighborhood know I'm going to sleep in the morning because mm-hmm. I work better mm-hmm. at night. And so I was up on that boat at like 3 in the morning. It was dark. And all of a sudden, I was out on the deck, and it had rained. And there were suddenly like sparks of fire flying all over the deck. The smokestacks of the American Queen had a power line that went from the Minnesota side to the Wisconsin side. And you know, anybody else who had been out there, could have been electrocuted, but I wasn't, as I'm here to tell the tale. But anyway, I had that experience on the American Queen. It was a problem on the boats of getting all the costumes on board. But it was a fun thing again. And I thought, how can I be doing this? You know, this is so wonderful. God is so good to me that I have this opportunity. And I had a lot of fun over the years collecting costumes. And tomorrow I go to the Bruce Moore Mansion in Cedar Rapids.
Oh, really?
And I'll be doing ragtime stories. So if you say, do I always do everything from the people? I try to. Mm-hmm. And I went to Marquette, Iowa, and interviewed a man at a bar who was in his 90s. And he could tell me about the original ragtime pianists. Uh-huh. And a lot of, so I get a lot of it by doing that kind of personal research. But tomorrow, I was just before I came here to meet you.
So you're going to be at Bruce Moore
tomorrow.
Yeah,
and I was wondering if my costumes would fit because I've gained so much weight. And I thought, I hope this fits because it's really, it's so flamboyant. Mm. And, you know, it's like a big red feather boa and feathers down here and all the stuff of that era. So I am thinking, here I wrote about the Capitol. Mm-hmm. The first paddle wheel that ever came to McGregor, Iowa, came up the river. And then I got on those other big paddle wheel boats. Mm-hmm. So I don't know now where the river is going to take me.
Well, it's still flowing down toward the sea.
It's still doing that.
Yeah, right. Well, it's been a delight to share your experiences with you, Doris. And good luck at Bruce Moore tomorrow, and good luck with your storytelling, which I'm sure you're going to continue doing.
Well, thank you so much for this time together.
It's been a pleasure.
I really appreciate it.
Mm.
It's been a fun experience.
Good.
And it's certainly the young cameraman here.
Jesse.
Are you in your senior year?
I will be a junior.
You'll be a junior. Mm-hmm. Good luck on your future.
Thank you.
Thank you.